Thanks everybody for joining our event today. Today we will be discussing our recent report on the palm oil supply chain. And before we get there, I would like to give a little bit of background on Chain Reaction Research. We are a consortium of Aid Environment, Climate Advisors, and Profundo, and we provide sustainability and financial risk analysis for investors in the forest in high-risk commodity supply chains. And we'll be discussing, as I mentioned before, a recent paper on the palm oil value supply chain. And the main author, Gerard Reich of Profundo, will be giving the presentation. And with that, I'd like to hand it over to Gerard.
Yes, thank you very much, Matt. Yes, a new report about who's earning the profits in the palm oil supply chain. First, a word on the context and the methodology. First, the context. The transparency enables clearly the stakeholders' discussions on the fairness of the distribution of costs related to the execution of zero deforestation policy. That's something which is very important. And for this, we have researched the supply chain and look to the various actors in the supply chain, plantations, smallholders, refiners, the biofuel industry, traders, oleochemical industry, fast-moving consumer good companies, FMCGs, and the retailers. The methodology that we used is that we needed to know the volumes which were produced and used and embedded by each company in each stage of the chain. So we needed to know the plantation output, and we needed to know the embedded volumes in the refineries, in the ingredient companies, in the oleochemical companies, the fast-moving consumer goods companies, and of course the retail. The problem in getting the data is that many companies have various activities, and there is not any separate palm oil information. For the volumes, we use the sources of WWF palm oil buyer scorecard and many other sources like annual reports, internet and sector data, and studies. In calculating the value and the profit margins related to the embedded palm oil, again, we used annual reports and Bloomberg, and we used for this the most relevant gross margins and operating margins. And price elevation, that's something crucial, occurs in every stage of the process and in every stage of the chain. So we look to the price for price elevation. We look to the pricing up from cost of goods sold to sales price. And we use that also, we use that for the embedded palm oil value. This methodology, it has been used in other studies before by Profundo, which is part of Chain Reaction Research, and it is peer-reviewed by three stakeholders, by three specialists. One, it's a retail specialist active in equity broking. Second one is an impact asset manager and investor. And the third is the Triodos, that's the leading green bank in the Netherlands and also active in some other European countries. This is a picture of the whole supply chain of palm oil and of crude palm oil and palm kernel. And in every stage of the supply chain, palm oil is further processed and or it is embedded in products with other ingredients. So it's It's in shampoo, for instance, but then also other products are there in that product. Crude palm oil is the biggest part. Palm kernel is a much smaller part of the market, but the big part of palm kernel also comes together again in crude palm oil later on in the phase. But crude palm oil, it can be used for biodiesel, but it needs to be refined. And a big part of the refined palm oil moves into food products, in home and care products, home and personal care products, oleochemicals, which are again sold to supermarkets and food service companies. In order to explain what we did, here is an example of the value analysis in the palm oil chain, and this is the part for the oleochemicals. And first, we try to find, of course, public information about the palm oil volumes and the margins in these companies. For instance, what is available is Avonik, AAK, BASF, and several others, which are, let's say, which we call oleochemicals companies. Because these companies show their public information, and we can use their gross profit margins and their operating profit margins to calculate the price elevation. When you have that price elevation, you can calculate the embedded value of palm oil. And by using the gross profits, gross margins and operating margins of the activity closest to the palm oil, you can calculate on the value of that embedded palm oil. You can calculate the gross profit and operating profit, which is generated by the part by the embedded palm oil. And these companies that we show here in the subtotal, they are, let's say, they give us an indication how the whole industry might look like. So the outcomes for the first for the subtotal, the group which was really available, the public information, we used as an assumption for the rest of the industry. In this case, we didn't change the gross margin. We used the same gross margin, pricing up, and operating margin for the top six, also for the rest of the industry, because we assumed that there was not much difference for the fast-moving consumer good industry and the retail. We did something else. But the rest of the industry was in 2/3 of the total oleochemical sector. As you can see, there was an embedded palm oil volume in million tons of 6 million tons here. And in net value related to palm oil, it is 7.9 billion euros. Gross profit is 2.5 billion for the whole group, for the group as a whole. And the operating profit is 727 million. Well, this is an example. You can also see here the price elevation. So the embedded crude palm oil price was 865. While they bought it for 865, while they sell it for 1,266, and that's a price elevation of 46%. We did exactly the same for all the other sectors, and then you get this outcome. Here you can see the money trail in all the sectors that we have calculated for, and smallholders, large plantations, refineries, including the biodiesel refineries, oleochemicals, we just mentioned them, fast-moving consumer goods industry, and the retail food service sector. As you can see, there is a total value generated in this in the palm oil value chain of 282 billion US dollar. And that is This value is only related to the embedded palm oil. And if you then use the most relevant gross margins, you come to the outcome for gross profits is $52 billion. And the operating profit only on the embedded palm oil is $18 billion. So in total, these companies make much more operating profit. But this is only for the part of the embedded palm oil volumes. And if you look to the price elevation in the chain, so the price at the plantation level was on average in 2020, $754 per ton. And because of the pricing up in every part of the chain, you can see that it moves up to $1,466 per ton at the retail level. And that means a total price elevation of 94%. If you put this same table, but then in percentage terms, and that shows you a very interesting outcome. You can see that the fast moving consumer good and retail generate the largest part of the profits in the palm oil value chain. So in total, taking them together, the fast moving consumer goods and the retail sector, in total, it is they generate 66% of the total gross profits and 52% of the operating profits. And you can see that that the other sectors have much lower percentages. If you look to the gross profits, where the fast moving consumer goods and retail at 66%, the smallholders, it's only 0%. Also the operating profits of the smallholders is 0%. This group, it's an enormous big group of participants. Overall, it's a group which consists of very poor farmers, which generate in total proceeds annually of $7,500 per year. And they have to they have to pay for education, for food, and that for 4.5 people on average. We assumed that this part of the chain, we could not talk about profits. This is just staying alive. And so it's 0%. And if you look to the larger plantations, yes, they make profits. They take around 30% of the gross profits, 23% of the operating profits. Biodiesel companies, 5% of the gross and 8% of the operating level. Rest of the refineries, 11%, 13%. Oleochemicals, 5%, and respectively 4% of the gross profit and operating profit. This shows you it a bit in a different format, and this is only focused on the gross profit. Again, you can see how the fast-moving consumer goods, they earn 38% of the total gross profits in the palm oil value chain, while the retailers earn 28%. And you can see that in the upstream sectors, the shares are much lower, and that most of the profits are generated in the downstream part of the palm oil value chain. If you have looked to our methodology, we've looked to the oleochemicals industry, how we started the analysis per sector, and as a consequence, we did it the same for each stage in the palm oil value chain. And therefore, you can also make a list of a top 10 or a top 11 in this case, because I wanted also to include a big retailer, which is Walmart. And you get a very interesting top 11 names of companies who are earning, who have the highest gross profits in related to embedded palm oil. And as you can see, well, it's of course a name you could expect. It's Wilmar. They have an enormous amount of palm oil is going through their infrastructure. It's 19 million tons of the in total 75.6 million palm oil produced in the globally per year. And they earn a reasonably big amount of gross profits and in operating profits, $703 million. Pertamina, it's the Indonesian state-owned refinery, and they blend fossil fuels with palm oil. And they are earning a large amount on this business. Unilever is, of course, one of the biggest sources of palm oil globally. They are smaller than the first two, but still earning on the embedded value nearly $700 million in gross profits. PepsiCo is a large one. AAK, well, we mentioned the company already in the oleochemical sector. Sime Darby, large implantation refinery. Procter & Gamble, Golden Agri Resources, Astra Agro, Listari, McDonald's. They, it's a company with not so much embedded palm oil, but with huge gross margins. And therefore, on all the embedded palm oil, they are in their system, they earn quite a lot. And the same is true for Walmart. Also here, the gross margins are relatively high in this company. The top 11, they are processing or palm oil through their infrastructure. That's 51% of the global palm oil volumes, 51%. However, they generate only 10 to 50% of the total value and profits in the palm oil value chain. And this is because the fast-moving consumer food and the retail sector take a big share in the total gross and operating profit in the palm oil value chain. But these companies, these sectors themselves are very fragmented. So Walmart is a big retailer, but globally they still have only a very small part of the retail market. So that is an important reason for this this difference between volume and value and profits. But it's an interesting table. Well, the outcomes that we have, and as I already started, the context of the of the study, we can now the outcomes of this profit report, we can confront them with outcomes of earlier and recent chain reaction research reports. And in those reports, we have calculated the costs for the fast-moving consumer good industry of an NDPE execution, monitoring, and verification policy and execution. And also the replanting costs for smallholders. And we use that information, that's in total, if we calculate for the whole sector, annual replanting costs is in the middle of the table, 1.1 billion for 25 years, 1.1 billion. All the aging palm oil trees are currently aging after 25 years of production. You need to replant. Smallholders have a problem, they are poor, they cannot replant on the existing plantations. And so the solution could always be, and that's just because of poverty, that they deforest land. And that is a problem in the whole chain. And we have included here the 5 billion of NDPE implementation, verification, monitoring costs for the whole fast-moving consumer goods industry. This is excluding economies of scale. If we would include economies of scale, technological developments, these numbers can go much lower, this 4.9 billion. But if you take these costs and you would also look which only to the palm oil related products that are sold, like a bottle of shampoo or a hazelnut chocolate pasta. If you then look to that, then you can see that these costs can be covered for a fast-moving consumer good company by only a 1.8% price increase. That is an average on products containing palm oil. And there are, and for the downstream, this kind of measures can be easily covered by the enormous value they generate in the chain on embedded palm oil. Well, for the plantation sector, it would be much more difficult. They would have to increase the price by 11%, or their gross profits by, and the gross profits could be hurt by 86% if they would have to cover all those costs by themselves. So let's say this is a, let's say, some input for investors to come to a more fair distribution of costs for making the whole palm oil value chain deforestation free. The benefits for fast moving consumer goods industry, the costs are relatively low compared to their gross profits on and their value generated on embedded palm oil. But they can, there is a huge reputation value increase to be gained for these. And these are at least 9 times higher than the cost. And these calculations are made in the already mentioned earlier reports made by Chain Reaction Research. I talked about 1.8% on average for the whole fast-moving consumer good industry. For some companies, the increases in sales prices necessary to have a more sustainable and a better verified palm oil value chain is much lower. So if you look to take a look to Procter & Gamble, this is a table used from an earlier report of Chain Reaction Research. We know that this company, or they say that themselves, that 20 to 40% of their revenues is dependent on palm oil. If we that take as a starting point, and we assume that they have to pay up around $65 per ton to have a much better execution, verification, monitoring of their palm oil supply chain, then they have to increase their prices only by 0.12% at retail level, or 0.15% at producer level. 0.15%. It means that a bottle of Head and Shoulders has to increase in price from, let's say, $3 to only $3. So we as consumers will not see the difference. Well, this is the end of the presentation. I'd like to thank you for watching and listening to this presentation. If you have any further questions, you can contact us through Chain Reaction Research or to myself, gerard.rijk@profundo.nl. Thank you very much.